How else do you catch a bird?
Fuck you! Box can't contain me!
See about that. Just eats his bird.
Actually, I wouldn't mind a balance of lesser violence.
Really? So we're gonna be good, peaceful boys and girls now? Well, just boy and girls.
Look, I didn't say nothing about no violence. I mean, people's got a personal stake in Chichi's glancing over at Mel, you know, and keeping some of them alive.
And also, I wasn't saying absolutely no violence. I'm just saying, like, maybe violence shouldn't be the first go-to.
Okay. You know what? We'll do it your way. Next time we come up against some opposition, I will do my level best to just solve it with diplomacy and just good negotiation skills. All right?
Well, okay, yeah, that sounds fine. I feel like you're mocking me, though.
No. I would never dream of doing that. I'll even say that, you know, when we get to it and they're saying, whoa, Van, you know, that's not what we're used to from you. I'll say, well, I met my good friend over here, Bernadette, who's convinced me that peace is an option. And when things don't go well, I will say, do not blame Bernadette for this, as I proceed to uppercut them until they generally stop moving. Because you did try. No one can say you didn't try.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't know how to argue with that. You're not wrong.
Taps the side of his head. See, this is the point of philosophy. Philosophical thinking will get you real far in New York City. And I'm a little bit of a scholar.
Yeah, it's very clear to see.
Yeah, sure, bud.
Think about it this way. Logically speaking, if peace were really a good option in most cases, what would we have done then in Elysium? You know, when all those people start sinking into the floor and getting laser eyes and all that. And peacefully speaking, I guess we should have organized some kind of social support network or drive to ensure that the victims of such an event would be taken care of as well as their families. And then we would try to file an action with the city to clamp down on club regulations and safety codes, would probably work hand in hand with fire marshals and the like. And insurance companies also would probably have to be on board so that we could talk to them about the risks that come with large spaces and events like this and disasters. Well, eventually we would hope to pass some sort of reform bill through our local representatives. We might even be encouraged to run for a political office, that sort of thing. This sort of process could take, oof, I don't know, 10 years, 15 in some cases, and the results will, of course, be fought against by moneyed interests who wouldn't want their bottom line to be hurt by all the different regulations that would have to be put into place to prevent such a catastrophe in the future, you know? So that's all going to be a pretty long, drawn-out process, and I guess I have time since I am young, after all, right now. But maybe by the time that we're 50, one of the people, or two of them perhaps, will see heavy fines and penalties applied to their estates, if they're still alive. Now, we could do all that.
Van, you're right. That has too many people it needs to be involved. It's not my preference.
Of course. Unfortunately, since I'd rather do other things with my time in my life than spend it in courtrooms and houses of representatives and such. I think I should just probably, you know, I'm going to keep in the back pocket that I could just roundhouse kick them as well through a window or a wall.
Look, I'm all for the roundhouse kicking. I just want to feed people that were trapped. That's all.
You should go in there then and give them, I'll send you in with a cook pot, some ingredients, simple seasonings, and I'll see you in a week.
I just want to, there's already food made!
It ain't gonna stay good forever, and time don't work the same way there as it does out here, you know.
Well, yeah, I sort of timed it with a smoke.
Now you're thinking that it's stable like that, but now the clocks don't tick at a steady rhythm. More like a pulse, goes up and down.
So it can slow down or speed up in there?
That's right, completely unpredictable.
Ah, shit.
As if by design or something.
Can you tell when that's gonna happen?
Absolutely not.
Maybe it's linked up to his heartbeat or something.
Yeah, I suppose that could be true.
So, if you're under stress, it's actually going faster.
A novel idea. So don't stress me out no more. Easy solution.
But that's my favorite fucking thing to do!
Find a new hobby. Why don't you take up fucking croqueting or something? Make yourself a nice fucking head cozy.
Got plenty of hobbies.
You know what kind of hobby you should take up, Billy? How about lip buttoning? How about that one?
Fuck you. Part of my hobbies is screaming. Give him a middle finger.
Maybe we should check in with Abdol.
Yeah, not a bad idea. They're actually professionals. I'm sure they have some kind of progress that they're making.
Yeah, you guys would like to head to the Speedwagon Foundation, then?
The church.
Yeah, just be the church,
or the
right?
Church. Yeah, you guys can head to the church.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can see if they have any leads.
Yeah. Let's head over. Did it not pull you guys?
I'm at 98%.
It always does this to me.
Oh, there we go.
I don't know why you guys are so tiny.
Because this cathedral is huge.
We've been shrunken down by the power of the Lord.
Yes, please respect him. Yeah, again, I don't know why their tokens are so tiny. Anyway, yeah, you guys can head over to the Trinity Church. There you will see... now, obviously, having taken up the role, Father Eric McFox is just kind of tending to the day-to-day. You know, it's a weekday. There's a few people gathered here and there, but otherwise it's generally quiet.
Until Van just throws the doors open and starts walking in loudly.
Yeah, with that, I think you would get, you know, most people's attention at that point. Also, yeah, Eric would catch you coming in and start going to meet you. Why, hello, Van. Once again, it is so great to see all of you. All of y'all seem to be doing quite well. perhaps maybe a little loud for some people's taste, but this is the Lord's house, and he will have anyone as his guest.
You say it's loud, but I seem to remember quite a bit of smiting and destruction in the Old Testament. God seems pretty loud himself, don't you think?
Well, yes, but I guess luckily for us all, especially the sinners, that he turned the other cheek and became a more gentler, humbler man. What do I owe this wonderful pleasure of you and your wonderful compatriots?
Most recently, Father, we ran into a little bit of a problem. What do you want to call it? A psychopath in a biker outfit tried to whack us in the most subtle of terminology.
Yes, that does sound very unfortunate for all y'all. I guess it is having to do with all of, and he kind of puts his arms out, this that's been going on.
Yeah, pretty much. Although, unfortunately, we also discovered that said biker psycho was just a bit of a cover, a costume, a mask, controlling whoever it was inside. In this case, he thumbs over to Mel. It was Mel's sister, someone we've been looking for, was missing. They're currently being contained elsewhere while we try to figure something out.
It's like your Stan took her over?
Right. Have you met Bernadette?
Yes, I do believe we have met before. He does hold out a hand for you to shake Bernadette.
Oh, yeah, I'll shake his hand. I have a philosophical question for you about creation.
Oh, yes, please do go ahead.
Yeah, so if something is brought to life and you are its creator and then you are immediately thrusting it into violence, does that make you a bad creator?
Eric listens to your question, and you can tell like he's contemplating it. He kind of runs his like index finger and thumb like down through his mustache, and then kind of strokes at his goatee before just kind of like nodding, like he kind of mentally found what he was looking for, and just goes, "Unfortunately, with the world we live in, Ms. Peterson, I believe that what you're describing here sounds just like anything or any time a life is given to us. When a child is born, unfortunately, we do not live in peaceful times, and they are born into the same levels of violence and destruction and chaos that the rest of the world has and will bring forth to them. But, you know, through nurturing the child, raising the child right, you know, allowing them to grow up in a good community and have a sense of self and worth, that they could become a good person who could bring about such change so that the next generation may not have to deal with that, but...
So that's the other thing. I don't know how long these things live for.
What things? Because you were being a little more ethereal, that was a very specific response.
Yeah, so I take out Becky.
He does see, because Becky's your book, right? Your notebook?
Yes.
Yeah, he does see your small pocket notebook come to life and kind of flap around. And he just kind of stares and like, he just goes, "Oh, well, And he's just kind of staring at it, and like, he's like looking it over. He's like watching this book essentially like flap, kind of like when you see a butterfly at rest, its wings will still kind of move, because the book has no limbs in which to do anything else. And he'll go, "Oh, I see. So you're very much like all of us here. I guess it would depend. I don't know the manner in which these things are alive. I don't know if they have a soul per se. So I guess you don't have to worry. I'll say this. I don't think you have to worry about a notebook going to hell. I don't believe that a notebook could be inherently good or evil. At the end of the day, it is a book. How it is used is based on the person who reads from it.
How did Becky feel when he said that, I don't know if this thing has a soul?
I would say it's probably just, it's still kind of in like a stasis. It's just kind of flapping every now and then, or like, you know, like kind of like how you can thumb through a page, like that sort of like thing. Like, it's just kind of doing that as like a, like, because it's, I guess it's like not in a pocket or anything. So it's just getting a little air. But it doesn't seem to like be offended at the, at what is being said.
Okay, so I can't tell if it has a soul yet or not. I was going to use that as a guidance.
If anything, Miss Bernadette, have you read the good book? Do you know of the Lord, your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ?
I've been to church a few times, yeah.
Okay. Well, part and parcel from Christianity, there are the Jewish people who have stories of things such as golems, which are creatures made by the high priests and rabbis of the time, used to perform various acts. They are not technically with a soul that is unique to them, but they are channeling the voice and the power of God directly through them, through ritual that, again, helps protect the people, the Jewish people. I would say you're probably doing some sort of approximation here. Again, I do not know your background, but...
Are you telling me that I'm a Jewish priest?
I'm saying it's similar. I'm saying I wouldn't go walking down to the synagogue tomorrow acting like you know what's what. They do have a lot of study involved. But I don't know that there's a cutoff age for transferring over.
No, I think that would really make my parents mad.
Well, in any case, if you want, you can always again give them a talking to. The doors are open.
Maybe they would know a little more.
Oh yeah, you can always go speak to them. I believe the only time that they are not in service is on Saturdays, but otherwise, they keep regular hours just like the rest of us.
You guys wouldn't mind going to the synagogue, would you? To get some answers.
I'm a street fighting gang member trying to get revenge and also stop the outpouring of corrupted power into the city. So sure, maybe sometime, maybe the synagogue sounds fine.
Nah, no, you're right. We got a lot on our plate.
We do. I got an aunt, I think, that converted to Judaism. I put you in touch.
Has Kareem been around?
You know, I did see him recently with Miss Joanne. Let me go see. I think he may have left some stuff for you. Excuse me. And he'll start to head back to his office. When he does come back, he does have a couple of papers. It's all like, you know, old 80s, you know, 80s printer paper. So it's all just like one sheet that's perforated. So you can kind of cut them up as you go. But otherwise, he will hand you the small stack that is paper clipped together. And just go, I believe you had questions for him. I suppose these are the answers. I haven't read through them.
Oh, All right, they're gonna go through the packet. What's in it?
Yeah, if you start going through the packet, yeah, dot matrix printer. If you start going through it, there's a lot of the same documents that he went over the last time you just talked to him regarding, like, the current theory on stands and what they are. There's talk of the arrows, how they were initially found, they were being researched, and then they went missing. And the Speedwagon Foundation has been slowly tracking them down and finding the individuals that have them in an attempt to return them so that they stop getting used to either murder people or give them superpowers that could fundamentally alter the world and reality. There's also some documentation on some more recent things. These don't look like they're official yet. It just seems like a lot of leads in regards to Elysium, finding out more about the owners, and everything about essentially Martin, and as well the supposed like new cocaine that he seems to be dealing in or is being dealt out of the club that seems to be related to the recent influx of stands in New York.
Yeah, so is there like a list of potential people that could have the stand arrows? Like, is Martin Score on that list?
There's some question. There's a list of individuals, but none of the names really stick out to you. But there are some of the names are like companies. And if you were to go through the paperwork, it's a lot of like shell companies that were opened and they bought something and then they sold it off and now they're gone and closed. And like the building that they worked out of supposedly doesn't exist. There's no address there. And so it's just them tracking down, basically like backtracing everything as far as they go.
Orange Dawn's not on that list, right?
You don't see it listed. If it's on there, it'd be like a derivative of a derivative. So you don't see it on there, but...
Is there anything Van would recognize? As in terms of shell company names or any names, I mean, his family is very moneyed.
Yeah, if you want to give it a look, you would see there's one... There's one on there that sounds familiar. It's another one of those like spin-off derivative things for a larger company called Eurythmic Pharmaceuticals. They do, you know, medicine. They work on vaccines, new cures, treatments, things like that. They have other smaller companies that do like makeup lines, beauty stuff, things like that.
Van's gonna point that one out. You what, Mike?
Nope, you're breaking up.
Yeah, was that me, I wonder?
I mean, that was Waffles.
I was gonna say, she was lit up, so I think she was trying to talk.
No, I think it just might be going off on its own. I didn't say anything.
Oh.
That's weird. Yeah, because I saw you light up, but then I just heard garble.
Van's going to point to the Eurythmic Pharmaceuticals. A good friend, Frank, was involved with some pharmaceutical-type dealings. It would seem to be his goal. He had a lot of... pretty proud pronouncements about what kind of impact he was going to have. So my guess, if we've chased this thread, we might be able to find something of import. Do they have a location in New York?
They do.
All right. I'm going to go here and I'm going to do some diplomacy.
You know, this sounds like it's worth a visit.
One thing you guys should be aware of, though. We've been dealing with mostly street-level thugs and foot soldiers. I get a feeling that once we start moving towards where the actual money is in this city, and this whole conspiracy, things will get a little bit more dangerous, to say the least.
Ain't the first time I fought moneyed interests.
Billy.
Yeah?
You know, I make a lot of jokes, but this is, I don't know how to say it. The things that you and your commune are about, the stuff you guys try to do, it is noble. I get it. But the moneyed interest that you've been fighting is like the one toe of a bigger foot, or a pinky finger on a whole hand. It's, and not even that, more like the tip or the nail. The stuff underneath the nail, even. And I do not say that to belittle any of your efforts. But the actual power system of money, the very root of corruption often in urban environments like this, is obfuscated by many different tiers of this. He kind of motions towards like all the shell companies, the names, the laws, it's this endless forest almost of just things hiding the monster that's inside of it. So I respect what you're doing, and I respect what you've done and where you've been, but when I say that it's a different level, you gotta take my word for this one. It is gonna be dangerous. I don't doubt that. It's dangerous enough where I'd say if any of you got a hope or prayer doing something else in life, you might want to take it now. Because once we go over and make ourselves known as a threat to the money, we fuck up their money. That's, I hate to say it in the house of God, but basically sacrilegious to these people. Blasphemy. You know, they worship mammon, that kind of thing. Like, just saying, expect this sort of religious fervor in response as you would from any faithful whose god you are attacking. In this case, their god is the dollar sign. You know what I'm saying? Good. The convictions are strong.
That's where I want to take it, then.
Now I'm hearing you, Dross, but I ain't gonna crawl when I can fly.
What about you, Bernadette? You got mixed up in all this. You sure you want to go head-to-head with some of these people?
Well, I know this wasn't my first choice, but, you know, if they're causing greater harm to the people of this country, then by all means, we need to do something. If no one else is gonna.
Damn straight, that's the American spirit right there. All right, Fodder. I got the info I needed.
Oh, all right. Well, I mean, if y'all need anything, of course, our doors are open to y'all. Maybe next time, maybe a call first, or just not banging through those doors so loud. I mean, there are other people here who are praying and seeking the Lord.
What? I didn't kick him in.
I'm not. It wasn't you, sweetie. You're more than fine.
Nah, it was me, of course.
Y'all a bit of a loud bunch, but I mean, that's, you know, Jesus also threw open the doors when he went in to remove those who were working to sell good. You know what? Just come on Sundays and I'll tell you about it.
Van's eyes light up,
and he goes, "Y'all know where the place is. It's been here."
When Father Eric says that about Jesus, Van's eyes light up. What other kind of violent stuff did Jesus do, actually, now that you mention it?
Well, it was mainly sort of the one thing. He wasn't a violent man. He was very much, in most ways, a pacifist. You know what? How about, again, why don't you come on Sunday and we'll learn together all about him, hmm?
Billy Lee's out. Oh, sorry.
Didn't he kill a person when he was a child because they said something about God, or I don't quite remember the whole thing.
What kind of fighting style do you think Jesus had?
I do not know. He was largely pacifist. He was the son of God. I assume if need be, he would just smite someone in the same way the Lord would. But again, I don't believe that he would be that kind of man.
I don't know. I hear he's really good at table tossing.
Well, yes, again, that's part of the same story. And you can see, like, he actually seems like, oh, God, one of them knows something about the Bible. And is like, there's, like, a relief that kind of hits him.
Oh, Jesus.
So, like, a professional wrestling type of style. Like a grappler.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what? If that'll get you here, yes. Jesus Christ was kind of like a wrestler, man. And he, and you know who he was subduing? Satan himself.
Van's eyes really light up. You're right. Thank you, Fada. That will provide me with the inspiration that I need to push forward with my mission. I'm going to be more Christ-like in the future.
I should, honest to God, hope so.
As always, you remain a spiritual inspiration in my life. And I, when all this is done, will, of course, thank you and make sure that your name is known as one of the people who gave me the ability to push ahead with what I am doing.
You've seen him smile, and you see, this seems a little more practice, and he goes, that sounds wonderful, Van. I sure do hope that all of God's blessings shine upon you, and that truly, you know, with all this said and done, that everything is taken care of and the right people are given glory. You know, again, to root out the true evil, you've got to get deep. So if you've got to go do whatever it is you're doing, go with God.
I will, in fact, go with God. Come on, God. And he turns around and starts walking. We got stuff to do, right? Hey, he ain't talking back, but that's okay. I know he's saying.
Yeah, alright. So, Eurythmia?
Yep. Eurythmical Pharmaceutical.
That's a reference.
Yes, it is. And it's also a mouthy fucking word. Yeah, we can head there if that's where we want to go. And since I don't have a map for that, we'll just go back to the city. But yeah, we can say you head there. It's in sort of northern New York. It's kind of right at the cusp in Manhattan of kind of like the downtown area, you know, where all the businesses, like Wall Street, stuff like that. It's located there. It's one of the, it's not in one of the newer buildings per se, but they do seem to own most of the floors when you guys get there. They have their own separate like lobby that's squared off from everybody else and cordoned off with like name tags and, you know, to get in, and security guards. It's got the whole nine. Yeah, you guys are there and ready to go.
I don't think they're just going to let us in without an appointment, though, are they?
I got an appointment with fate. Nah.
Yeah, look, you guys can head in.
Yeah, Van's just gonna... He's just gonna go in. I ain't even trying to hide why I'm here.
All right.
I'm with the group. I'm just gonna follow.
Yeah, y'all head in. You do get some looks from people. Obviously, you are a ragtag bunch. None of you are dressed business casual at the minimum. Maybe Bernadette would pass, but
I am in overalls.
Never mind. Then nope. You guys are just a bunch of weird looking artists that just walked in. But yeah, you head to the main counter. The receptionist who watched you come in will just go, "Can I help you?"
Maybe. I am looking for some people that can provide some answers to me. And as you are a receptionist, I assume that you could connect me with such people. But I also know the protocol for these sorts of things. So, how about we just skip to the chase and, can I talk to your head of security or something?
Okay. In regards to, do you know something? Some sort of...
I'd rather talk to them about it. Honestly, it is a bit of a confidential matter.
Right. And may I ask who is asking for him?
Oh, God. Tell him it's...
It could be me.
Really?
Yeah. Don't blow your cover if you don't have to.
Nah.
Say your sister's name.
Sylvia?
Yeah, he's working for him.
We could try that. Sylvia Mel's asking.
Okay, yeah, he's kind of eyeing you all as you're talking and just goes, okay. He'll like kind of scoot over in his rolling chair to the phone. And make the call and just go, yeah, no, I don't know, Sylvia Mel? Something about that. Yeah, you can come down. Yeah. And he hangs up and just it'll be just a second. You're more than free to take a seat. There's some chairs over there. You could stand by the doors or walls, I guess. Like, he doesn't really know how to handle you all.
Oh, like, don't worry.
In an offensive way, just...
We got it covered. Van's gonna lean against the wall. He's just like... He's just taking up the most typical JoJo pose, weirdly. Like, slightly leaned over, looking, like, suspicious, but also just voguing. Yeah,
everyone JoJo pose.
There's room for everyone to JoJo pose.
All lean on each other randomly.
Yeah, randomly entangled for no reason. Or, like, Van's semi-squatting and has his hands on his thighs and is, like, leaning to the side or some shit.
Yeah.
We'll just look normal over here.
Yeah, you guys are squatted up. Well, because it's also the 80s, so, like, there's, like, b-boys and stuff like that. So, yeah, you guys are in this just general, like, pose. And so, eventually, the head of security, like, an older guy, a little bit of a gut on him, will come walking out and just kind of see you all and just go, which of yous is Sylvia or Mel? Sylvia? Anyway, you got a security problem?
Whatever. Mm-hmm. It's me. I'm Sylvia Mel.
Okay. I apologize, Miss Mel. So what exactly is going on? You say there's something... some kind of security risk, but you won't divulge it unless you talk to me. And now I'm here.
Melina's gonna look to the group real quick because she doesn't know what her sister's involvement with this group was.
Frank's in trouble.
Yeah. Van's gonna just stand up right in front of the security guy. Look, to put it lightly, we have been involved in a series of altercations with people representing or otherwise connected to this pharmaceutical business you have here. In addition to that, we have also come into some knowledge that there may have been the transportation and, I would call it smuggling, but I'm sure other people would state it in a different way, of certain artifacts that we have become very aware of as being a problem. Those artifacts, these people, they come up a lot. So now, instead of coming here and starting a whole lot of trouble, I've decided to take the advice of my good friend here, Bernadette. He motions to Bernadette.
I wave.
And engage in a bit of diplomacy with some of the powers that may be responsible for these incidences. You know, like... Do you understand what I'm saying, or should I be less subtle?
Okay, do you have any names of the employees that work here? When you say that, he does kind of, like, his eyes open a little, and he goes, Mr. Depp, you all know Mr. Depp.
Know him? We left him in a dumpster, and then he vanished. So, yeah, we know him.
Yeah, you just casually dropped that you left a man in a dumpster somewhere. And he kind of furrows his brow and just goes, you know what? Surprisingly, I'm not the guy you need to be talking to. Why don't you give it a few minutes? I'll be right back. And you see, as he's walking away, he... will reach over. He has one of those, like, over-the-shoulder, like, walkie-talkies. And he starts talking into it as he's walking back behind, like, the, you know, the key card of, like, turnstile to go back.
All right. While we are waiting, I recommend that you follow the Van Dross School of Fighting Etiquette. He's gonna scan around the lobby here. What kind of materials... is this place, generally, does it seem like they use in construction?
It's, I mean, you've got, like, your glass wall that's kind of, you know, letting the sun in. There's marble floors, marble walls, you know, just basic kind of chairs and seating and stuff like that. So you could probably guess that they're made of, you know, wood, you know, plastics, glass, probably some, you know, some steel in there, you know, like the nuts and bolts and all that.
He's going to lean down like he's tying his shoe and have Ashes to Ashes use a finger to crack some marble a little bit near the ground or like near the floorboard, something in a corner to like just pick a little material and kind of piece by piece. He does that around as he's, like, stretching his arms and acting like he's just trying to stay limber. Very subtly trying to gouge out or gather small bits of material that he's noticing in places where it won't be noticed that anything's missing or there's any even cosmetic damage. To gather a piece of marble, of wood. I don't know where he's going to get glass, but actually it wouldn't be too hard, I guess.
Yeah, we can say, you... are slowly breaking up little bits of everything. Just kind of ashes to ashes, just kind of pressing a finger through each material until it cracks and gives way, and then, you know, kind of palming it and then carrying it over to you in a subtle way, because obviously since the stand isn't seen, it would just be floating dust traveling through the air. But yeah, you do collect little bits of each material.
Yeah, I guess would I still have glass in my hair? Probably.
I would say yeah. At some point, yeah, you either have glass in your hair or like shaking it off of your body, like it probably landed in a pocket or something. That's how they always get you on CSI.
Yeah.
You always got glass in your shoe from when you murdered the guy.
Of course.
Once he's got all that, he kind of like holds it, pockets some of it in different pockets. these sorts of things are what make a difference in any kind of confrontation. Which I expect, once we name drop and say what we're here for, is going to be a little bit of an inevitability. However, I am still following the Bernadette Peterson School of Diplomacy, and so I will not be firing first.
Is there like a water cooler around here?
No, you're kind of in like a general like sitting waiting area. They don't have anything really that's hospitable in that sense. There's likely stuff in the back if you were somebody who had an appointment with somebody here.
You don't think they're calling the cops, do you?
Nah, I doubt it.
Alright. That makes things easier.
Once we get to a certain level of dealing with this intrigue, the police are largely there to be cardboard cutouts. Plus, I'm rich, and I can afford lawyers.
That makes one of us.
Could be two of us, you know. I could adopt you.
You could... Yeah?
Yeah, you could be Billy Dross.
Nah, fine with my grandfather's last name.
Forget that. I'm using her to escape this place.
Yeah, I would say eventually the head of security does come back. There is a little bit of a waiting period for you guys, but he does come back, and he does have with him, he has with him a woman who's very tall, slender. She has like a shock of short red hair, kind of cropped, very neat. You know, big 80s shoulder pad. You know, business suit. Who's actually leading in front of him, and she comes up and just, "Hello, you knew Frank?"
Well, no, unless he's dead.
Well, you did tell my head of security that you did dump his body into a dumpster. How quickly should I call the police?
Well, no, he was alive when we did that.
And it was to save his life.
Oh, right. These are all normal things you tell people. In the middle of a Tuesday. So you were looking to see if... I guess I'm a little confused. He came into work after being dumped in a dumpster.
I don't think that's what happened to him at all. I think someone picked him up, probably found him. Same people is probably trying to kill him. Hey, the question is, was it your people or was it someone that you know of? You can drop the act, really. The mask, it don't look right. It ain't Halloween.
She gives a very flat smile and just goes, "You know, she turns to the security guard and just kind of gives a head shake. He starts to walk away. And she goes, "You know, you're right. Why don't we go to my office? We can talk this over. Shall we?"
Sure. You got sparkling water?
I'm sure we can have some for you, yes.
All right. I see we're moving up in the world.
Yeah, she will start to lead you and get you through and into an elevator and all the way up towards the top floor. As you guys are kind of in the elevator in this kind of just tense silence, She was the last to get on the elevator, so she's very much at the front of you all. She has not turned around at all to face you. And there's no, like, the metal doors are not, like, hyper-polished to reflect anything. So, like, you don't even get that from her. She just goes, "My name is Belinda. I am Frank's, I suppose, senior would be the right word, because he tried to treat me not like a boss, but that was his genius for you. So you say you know him from outside of work, obviously. I know he tends to run with a certain crowd. He seems to believe himself certain things. So you assume that what, him and his other nepotism baby friends are infighting, or?
That's about right.
Hmm. And you think this has something to do with the research he does here?
In a way. Either you are involved or you are being unintentionally involved in a little bit of a, how do I say it? Illicit pharmaceutical production scheme? Now, I understand that there are probably powers in this world that are a little bit above usually what we deal with. But when it comes to the fact that these sorts of things can be at all traced to your company, because make no mistake, the reason I'm here is they were in fact traced. When it gets that sloppy, question is, whose mistake was that? Was it Frank's? Was it his senior's? Somebody else in the company might have gotten in his ear? I don't know. But the fact of the matter is, it's a little bit more than just him and his nepotism buddies. They didn't just get drunk and then run over a homeless person or something. Them producing some really serious stuff. Disastrous stuff. And I mean that sincerely when I say disaster. You aware of Club Elysium and what happened there?
She doesn't turn around and she goes, I mean, there's obvious reports of what happened there, both, what was it, several days ago even, and several weeks ago beyond that. I know Frank and his little friends play around in there and treat it, whatever, like a whorehouse, opium den, whatever word you want to use for that sort of life. But if he's allowing his own research to eke out into the world for whatever reason he may have, then that is a much larger issue for us. But yes, I am aware, I guess, to keep it short. I do know that him and his buddies, if you would even call them that, were, I guess, doing illicit things and drugs there, and unfortunately, they seem to be trying to find a new high to chase, or some sort of thing, and that is now affecting my bottom line and bringing you all here. You're obviously not police. I would never believe that in a million years. So you clearly just have a vendetta against him. What, does he owe you money? Are you his dealers? Some other fellow junkies?
Oh boy, if it were that easy, you'd be able to just shovel a bunch of pills into our pockets and we'd probably disappear under a bridge and OD, right? Nah, ain't like that. See, the fact of the matter is, I'm the king of New York now. Or at least, I'm gonna be real soon. A whole city. And everything in it will be under my domain and dominion. In order to get there, unfortunately, I have to sort a few things out. Including Frank Depp and his business. And if you're part of his business, then I'm afraid I'm gonna have to sort you out too. No, I ain't no junkie. Certainly not anything like that. And dealing drugs? Ain't my business either. You know who I am, I'm sure. Or at least you heard the name. Van Dross. A little bit of a prodigal son of the Dross family. And ever since I got wrapped up with all this stuff that Frank's been doing, there's really nowhere to go but up, because the ground's burning. People getting assassinated in the streets. Regular partygoers just happen to be swept up in the madness that your little friend Frank decided to make his business. Turn everything into a little bit of an experimental treatment facility, any club that he goes to. He's slinging this stuff. Now, diplomacy is really why I came here, of course. You can't just punch all your problems away. So I'd like to hear you out. I really, really would. A very wise man told me before he was swept up and killed in the violence caused by all of this, told me that I should really try to be merciful. You know what I mean? Merciful. And mercy's a big word. It's only 5 letters, but it's a really big word. So I gotta have some mercy. And you right now, I think, have not done anything quite yet that would make me think that that would be difficult to do. I don't really expect that to change. Do you?
I would say when you mention your name, she does actually turn her head to look at you. And at this time, the elevator reaches its destination. She steps off as you finish, and just kind of like puts an arm out to kind of guide you the way.
Follows.
Yeah, you guys start heading off. She leads. You are in, like, there are some, like, offices. They're all, you know, these rather large offices, but kind of pocketed in between them are these, like, lab spaces where you can see some people working. You know, there's some people in their offices working as well. She eventually gets to, a corner office and will let you all in. She will sit down at her desk and look at you all and go, obviously I cannot speak about what Frank may or may not have been working on, where he may have gotten what he was working on, and any developments that were found or not found, issues that may have arisen from those. It's all, you know, very NDA, very hush-hush. But if what you're saying is true, then obviously Frank is very much in a bad position. He is intentionally leaking corporate, I don't even want to say documents, but he may have the paperwork. But truly unpolished work, even for him, out into the city streets and sort of flooding and overrunning them, if everything is to be believed. Which does seem a little odd for him, but I don't know the kind of friends he keeps, so. And she just kind of gives a simple shrug.
We know what kind of friends he keeps.
Well, then I would ask that, and she kind of like stiffens up and scoots herself even closer into her desk. She goes, if he has what he, if he's taken his work and gone elsewhere with it, his contract is very ironclad, and it is very specific in what will happen to him, at least in terms of his job, his prospects, blacklisting, etc., etc. And he would know that. And he should know better, but if he doesn't, then clearly, whatever he was promised, whatever, I don't know, end game he has with stealing from us, he will pay that price from someone. What he was dealing with was very high level, very cutting edge. It would and could change the world indefinitely. But again, it wasn't focused. It was still raw material in terms of application, if that makes sense. And she's kind of like, she's trying to judge, based on all of that, what you might know, what you might not know. Because obviously she, as well, can't just be like, stands! It's all ghosts, and because, you know.
Pretty sure it's already changing the world.
Yes, it seems as though the hands or wheels of fate have begun spinning a new yarn. But it seems a shame that Frank, who wanted so badly to be the one guiding that hand, now seems to be the one under the wheel. Getting... And when she says, she says getting, and she, like, her one fist, like, tightens on her desk. Rolled over.
What's her office look like?
It is, mostly just white on white. She obviously, with a corner office, just, you know, two walls are, you know, lined with windows showing out the skyline. She has like two different plants that are like opposite each other, against one wall, and like all the chairs and stuff are like glass, metal, like chrome. It's very it's got that very sleek, like futuristic, like minimalist kind of vibe to it. She has, you know, like you see some awards, or maybe her doctorate, master's degrees, etc., are framed, in not like a normal framed, it's just like two pieces of glass, and then the, you know, the diploma's wedged in there, and then like just bolted to the wall.
This is a fancy office you got. How long you been working in this industry? How long did it take you to get here?
I have worked here at Eurythmical for, I would say, 5 years, but overall I've worked about 15 years in the industry, so to speak.
Wow. 15 years. You know, that's quite a long time, especially to people like us. Well, we're fairly young. You seem like a more mature individual, more seasoned life, more experience, more to gain, more to lose, that sort of thing. It's impressive in a lot of ways to look at someone like you and see all you've done. End up in a position like this, where now you're on really the cutting edge, exactly, of what industry you're in. It's really something. He looks at the, does she have a corner office?
Yes.
Yeah, he looks at the windows, the corner office, looking out onto the street. And he points out towards the skyline. A lot of people out there, they've done the same thing. They built up these great towers and industries. These incredible skyscrapers, really. The city is known for having some of the most impressive in the world, dating back, in some cases, well over a century by now. New York City has been very much a birthing place for corporate powers such as this. And even beyond that, coast to coast, New York has influenced and been this beacon. And yet... He holds up a finger. And yet, this precarious situation remains. This is all a house of cards. When the economy is shaky, when people get nervous, or when a disaster strikes, business like this, and those that are even larger, of course, can sometimes dissolve practically overnight. Shareholders get nervous, and buildings come down. So, the reason I say all this is because I do detect the air of, how do I say it, invincibility. I detect this feeling, I think, from you and associates like Frank, that there is always going to be these walls and this ceiling and this floor beneath your feet, and that no mere mortal's ever going to change anything about that because they're not rich enough or they're not connected enough or that sort of thing. But unfortunately for you, it is not merely the case that those are the what protect you. In fact, the really thing that protects people, like those that work here and you in particular in this instance, the only thing that protects you is how reasonable and rational someone is when they're in this sort of position and their name happens to be my own. See, I have what you would call somewhat something of the result of the research that you've been doing. And the way that it has affected me is I am more or less now a force of nature, or like an act of God. And I don't mean that literally, but in a way I kind of do. I've been getting into religion lately, and I talked to a priest who had some really interesting insights into how to be more Christ-like. For example, he grabs hold of her desk. I hear he did a little bit of this, and then he just tips the desk over and slams it onto the ground and everything on it as well.
She scoots back so that like obviously you don't like hit her. But yeah, otherwise she just watches the desk kind of tumble and fall over. And she just locks eyes with you again and just goes, that may be. But again, Frank isn't here, and I suspect if I were to go check his labs now that most of his research, or at least any physical pieces of his work, would be missing or completely gone, in which case there will need to be some work done on my end to sort of plug the leak in this impossible to sink ship.
Impossible, you say?
Yeah, you see her get up and she kind of tugs at her suit jacket and straightens up and just goes, yes, you know, they said the same thing of the Titanic, but we all know where it ended. Excuse me. I hope you'll steer yourselves out. If not, I'll have someone find you.
No. He holds up a finger. You're not going anywhere right until I get the answer that I want. And it's not going to be one that's vaguely worded or nicely put. In fact, I can make you a promise right now. If I don't feel satisfied with the answer that I get from the question that I ask, I will bring this entire building down to the foundations. I will do it. Like an act of God, there will be no explanation for why it happened. Your insurance and justice will probably assume that you cut corners on construction. Or maybe it might have been some kind of strange explosion caused by faulty wiring. And if you're lucky, you might even get the chance to jump from a window before the whole thing collapses. That's if you're lucky. You're not going to make it, of course. We're very high up. Now, I'm not a terrorist or nothing. Don't get me wrong. Like I said before, I am royalty here. But if you think I'm going to let you just kind of smooth talk your way through something like this and then walk out the door and go make whatever calls so that people start showing up again and trying to put holes in me or my friends, you got another thing coming, lady. So you're going to answer my questions. And then I'm going to take some assurances so that I can solve the problem on my own terms and not let somebody else's money dictate exactly what's going to happen to people's lives. If you are not compliant with my very reasonable request, by the way, very logically constructed, I assure you, philosophically aligned. If you don't just play ball for a moment with me, you're going to find that sometimes crazy people really do mean what they say, and they aren't always just out of their mind. They also, you know, maybe the guy really does have a dynamite vest strapped to him or that sort of thing. Now, you don't want to take that gamble. You didn't get to where you were by taking big, big risk like that. Everything really needs to be in place. You got to know you're going to win at the table before you sit down. Otherwise, you're going to be that guy out in the back alley with the bottle in the brown bag, wondering about what would happen if he had hit it big instead of losing his whole home. No, you need to know that the game is rigged before you play it. You obviously have the game rigged. I just want to know a little bit more about, I guess, how much of a trail of destruction I'm going to have to leave before I'm done with this just matter, this chapter of a much larger book. So, you can either answer my questions, and I am still using diplomacy here. He looks at Bernadette. I'm being diplomatic. I see your judging eyes. Judging me. He turns back to her. I'm being diplomatic here. Because I am really, really pissed off. People died. A good man was shot while he was trying to bring peace to people. And if all you're gonna do is look at me with your very nice haircut and very lovely suit, by the way, it does fit you very well. You have a very good fashion sense. If all you're gonna do is just do all this, I'm gonna be inconsolable. I might get irrational. Let's help me to stay rational. Just give me a few answers and I'll be out of your hair, I promise you. I don't wanna really have to be back here unless I'm not feeling well, and there's some kind of experimental treatment that perhaps your company could provide. But I'd rather not really darken your doorstep anymore. I just want to get my answers and go. I don't want to see any pharmaceutical suits or proxies around the corner following me. I don't want to hear nothing about, you know, oh, it was just a lone gunman who came into the Dross residence, decided to try to rob the place, accidentally killed everyone. I don't want to have to deal with that. And if I have to take certain cautious steps to make sure that don't happen, I will. I will do so. No, I'm not paranoid either, before you ask. So I just want to know. Just one or two questions. Really, we'll just be out of here. You can take my word for it. It's good as gold. For example, clenches and unclenches his fist. Certain arrows have been transported here and there, and your company happens to be linked to the transportation of such relics. Now, because Frank decided to monkey around with things that are related to those, in the form of a very designer cocaine brand, it seems that now I am looking at, perhaps, you can correct me if I'm wrong, one of the people who are responsible for putting that arrow perhaps in his hand, or at least getting him close to it. Because of that, that makes you just as liable as he is for any damage that those things have caused. You can't hide from the eyes of God behind corporate subterfuge and a bureaucracy. Rest assured, I personally won't allow that to happen. Your company's not worth your life, lady. So all I want to know is, are you responsible? Is there more of them? And who I really need to be beaten up and threatening? Because I'm going to guess it probably ain't going to be you. Make me someone else's problem, really. You could be there to pick up the pieces, put on the whatever hat they were wearing. This could all work out for you just nice.
yeah, she takes a moment, looks around at her discarded desk, and then looks at you and looks at and you and your friends, everybody here. She will just go, I wouldn't necessarily call them arrows. I mean, they are shaped like arrows, but what they are is a miracle. I have never seen anything like what they are and what they, the potential really that they could hold. Yes, unfortunately, they do seem to have a very big drawback, but I mean, I guess if you're playing with the powers of God, there does need to be a price that is exact in what it can give and what it can take. That, again, when speaking, and she kind of makes a little like sour face, vaguely, was the ironing out. Obviously, no one wants to die, and we were trying to remove that as an option.
You're telling me they're going to make us some, these arrow stands are going to make it people immortal?
I mean, they could. What we were looking for actually was that there is, there's an off chance that when pierced or cut with the arrow, and she does like an air quote, the material, when it causes the initial infection that we saw, the body will either develop a natural resistance and immunity to it and overcome it, or it will succumb almost instantly to the disease that it holds. We were trying to eliminate the death part of the infection.
Did you say that you were going to eliminate the death part as an option?
Yes. Would you, if you were going to be taking,
if someone, why not just remove it entirely? Don't leave it in.
Well, yes, but we have to work on it. That's what Frank's work was essentially a mainstream, she says mainstream, and you could tell that that's kind of a force of just having it, trying to find the right word for it, vaccine, if you will, for the virus inside of these arrows. We were trying to eliminate the dying, a guarantee to godhood. You understand why that's important when the other option is death.
You hear that, guys? We're gods now.
You say that, and she kind of you can tell she probably caught on, but you all saying that you're gods just kind of elicits like a sigh from her. And she goes, yes, you and Frank and I assume many others, again, based on all of the news reports that are coming through, all of the rags that are mentioning this, that, and the other. But that part is neither here nor there. But yes, the rise, unfortunately, in these deaths relating to individuals taking this new drug seem to be in the same way in which any sort of living material would react to the arrows, which again, Frank was supposed to be developing a way to remove that, the vaccine. If he ran off with all of that, then here in this building, at least, we likely have nothing. He may have entered it into one of our computers, but we'd have to go searching through the computer. He mostly kept notes to himself.
Also, wait a second. Are you implying that he is holding the whole bag of this research? There's no backups? No nothing?
He and the other researchers here are given very, very small quantities to work from. No one has... there's very, very, very... And I do stress the word very few people here who could access all of it at once. If Frank is stolen it, he's stolen it out from the noses of everyone around him. But I haven't heard anything from anyone, so he's either somehow using whatever, I wouldn't say measly to me, to myself, but maybe to you all, his vast wealth here as a researcher to, what, pay off blackmail, bribe? He doesn't have that kind of money, and quite frankly, he does not have that sort of menacing presence to scare anyone enough to give up something as important as this.
Vance's face kind of drops. Yeah, or he could be using an ability of sorts to just synthesize stuff, like, remotely wherever he is.
Well, I suppose he could if he decided to use what was given to him on himself, like a fool. And, like, again, like, she, like, white knuckles her fist. And you actually hear, like, knuckles crack as she does it. She kind of relaxes her hands and just goes, if that's the case, again, we have our own people, our own policies on returning to us what is ours. And we will be using that full force for something as important as this. You understand. She kind of eyes you all. Of course, you understand the severity of this still running around. If news of it were to get out, it would just remove us completely. I don't know of any way in which we would recover. And we likely could, but it would be very, very damaging. And I don't want to print new business cards, so... If you're... I don't know what this shakedown was other than to get more information. If you're asking to find him, please do. Bring him right to my office. Or throw him at the doors. And we'll handle the rest on our end.
I'd like to, quote-unquote, open my wings behind my back. Does she seem to notice it?
Yeah, you can flap. You can essentially extend the wings out of Rebel Yell. Like, are you doing it to, like, create a gust of air, or just, like, surprise? Like, you know, like a cockatiel?
I'm just checking if she can see Stans.
She's pretty much kept her eyes squared on Van the whole time. She doesn't break that eye contact with him.
All right, I fold my wings back and snort once.
Van's going to lean the desk back up, pick up the things that fell off of it, and start putting them back. Just quietly doing it.
Yeah, she's watching you do it.
It's not a very good job, but he even turns the thing to maybe how it might have been turned slightly, puts papers back, sort of how they were put on the desk. In general, puts everything back in place. He takes a moment, puts his hands on his hips, looks it over, and starts adjusting a few things here and there to make the details a little bit closer to what they were before he tipped the desk over. And then finally he takes a step back, holds his hands open. All right. I'll tell you what. I am passionate about my work. Whatever you might decide to call my current form of employment. Self-employed is actually how I'd like to think of it. When I say that I am the king of New York, I mean it. I really do. So here's what's going to happen. I'm going to take care of this problem with Frank. And because you haven't really given me any names of other people that might be connected other than Frank. I'm gonna assume that you do have some responsibility here, whether you like it or not.
She just kind of gives a shrug, and she goes, if you want my honest opinion of Frank, he was a neurotic, very self-centered, thought way too highly of himself. Initially, I would say of his own abilities, but then once he was given access to the aero material, he actually did start to back it up, I will say. That, though now looking at what can happen with exposure to these elements, that it may be that his own... And she kind of like does a quick little like hand wave in the air. Je ne sais quoi, his potential may have been artificially boosted by these abilities that one can gain. So yes, I 100% would see him as the main cause. No one else here is running around with playboy millionaires and hedge fund nepotism babies, you know, families who have owned things and people and places in this town for longer than any of us have lived here. Well, and she kind of looks at you, Van, and just kind of goes, some of us, I suppose.
Do you have any of those stand arrows here?
She shakes her head. She goes, we have many facilities around the world, unfortunately. Or fortunately, I guess, depending. We were sending samples, small samples, I will stress that. The same way some would file down, wood or sand it down and just collect the grains is what they were using. Obviously, we were afraid exposure to the full arrow and being pierced or cut or in other ways affected by the arrow would lead to greater results. It does not appear to be the case, though, as it seems you all and Frank and many others have been exposed to it and seem to be... And she just kind of stares at you all and just goes, empowered, given some sort of command over things outside of my own purview. And quite frankly, it can stay that way. I don't want to play and gamble. I work on sure things. And I can assure you, it is a sure thing that Frank is in fact a spineless man who would crawl over the backs of others laid out before him to get an inch higher out of the waters if he were drowning.
Van looks very thoughtful as he listens. All right, now I'm sure of it. The reason I didn't mess you up just now is because I think I like you a little. Your assessment of Frank seems totally, totally on point. Yeah, it'd be a shame if I really had to mess you up or anything. I don't want to have to do that. Look, I'll make you a deal. Really mercy kind of deal. And I hope you take me seriously on this. I'm going to need you to get in contact with a group called the Speedwagon Foundation. They need to know more information about potential threats like this. And unfortunately, they are currently really scrambling at the ground level to contain fires that they might have been able to stop. There is a very good chance that this Frank incident wouldn't have occurred if they had been maybe in some way informed. And because of the veil of corporate bureaucracy, nonprofit groups like that probably just don't even get the opportunity to do the good that they could.
You mentioned the Speedwagon Foundation, and she kind of like... It's not a full sneer, but she does make a little bit of a face, and she goes, I suppose I can get in touch with them. Is there anyone in particular that I need to speak with? As far as I know, they're nothing more than a bunch of archaeologists, preservationists. They do works everywhere, but it doesn't seem to be of any note. But I suppose I will let them know.
There's a representative that we're currently working with in the city by the name of Avdol. Yeah. I'm going to need you to actually get in touch with him. When I say you get in touch, I do mean you. They need to hear your voice and know who you are. Because what you don't want, obviously, is loose cannon like me marching into your office, making a mess, yelling and screaming, saying a bunch of stuff you don't want people to hear, that sort of thing. You can make this nice and clean. And like I said, I don't have to darken your doorstep anymore. I really don't. I don't got to be back here. I don't got to even say any other word to you. Maybe you want to invite me for a nice cocktail party or something? I'll go and I won't even cause trouble. I'll order something reasonable off the menu or whatever. The bartender's got a list. He can make stuff, pretty quick. Like a Manhattan. A pretty good one. Or I'll even drink a Cosmo if that's what the liquor is, But or I don't have to do anything like that at all. I could just have a nice... night with a Coca-Cola and some ice, and then I can say hello and leave. We don't have to do anything unpleasant, violent, or vulgar. Everything could be nice and reasonable. What makes it unreasonable, oftentimes, is that we treat each other like children and such. We could just talk like adults. We can handle this like adults. There doesn't need to be any sort of violence. My good friend Bernadette here has taught me that the importance of diplomacy lies more in the ability to get things done with the minimal amount of destruction required, not the maximum amount. I usually go maximum.
We do like the maximum.
But in your case, I am willing to go minimum amount of destruction, really. If you're reasonable, you play ball, you call the speedway, and I do mean you. I know your face. I know who you are now. I just need you to actually make that contact. I just need to feel... I need to feel safe and secure. Not like a foster puppy. I just need to know that where I'm going is gonna be nice. Or I'll start biting and shitting on everything. Know what I mean?
Yeah, you mentioned the foster puppy thing, and again, she kind of sneers and she goes... Well, I don't have a fondness for animals. I do get your point, Mr. Dross. You can be assured that your contact, Mr. Kareem, will be reached out to. She looks over and, you did put her phone back on her desk, but it clearly, got a little busted up when you flipped everything. And she goes, it will be as soon as I can.
Of course. And you can send a bill for any... any replacements of your office supplies to the Dross household, it wouldn't be the first time. We lost a lawyer because I beat the shit out of him. Surprisingly, he did not press charges, which you'd think he would. Yeah. Well, I guess that's that. Oh, wait a minute. He holds up a finger. Yeah, before I go... Hold on one fucking second. Where's that sparkling water? You said you had some.
She looks at you, and for the first time throughout this whole thing, you get what is likely an actual smile. She will walk over to it's just sort of like a wall. It looks like there may be some kind of cabinets within them. And eventually she'll kind of press her hand against it and the cabinet door will start to open. And inside you see there's, all sorts of waters, refrigerated, other drinks. Looks like, some kale smoothies or other just green drinks that are all they have labels on them. That you can't really make out from there because she is kind of standing in the way of them. She'll grab 4 bottles of water and walk over and hold them out. Each one kind of nestled between the knuckles of her fingers towards you. I hope you have a great day, Mr. Tross, and the rest of you as well.
Alrighty, he takes his bottle. Well, if I hear that you didn't call, I will be back. And next time, I'm going to make sure that you have a better view of the city. You won't have a wall anymore.
Understood, Mr. Tross. And you tell Frank when you do see him that he won't have to worry about emptying his desk. I'll personally make sure it finds an incinerator. He's fired.
Oh, that's probably not the worst thing that's happened to him recently, but it won't feel good. I understand, though. Professional standards are really important.
And she kind of gives a nod. Just goes, of course.
You don't happen to know a place he'd fuck off to, do you?
No, unfortunately.
Or because he could have also been taken, so, or anyone who might want to take him.
I only know that he goes home and goes to that silly club with his friends.
Well, I got an idea, too. I think I could probably figure it out. I'm a little bit of a private detective right now. King, private detective, gang leader. I wear so many hats.
Do we know the names of all of his friends? Like, in character?
Yeah. You met them the first time at Elysium, and most of them introduced themselves, or they were introduced to you. So you know Frank, then there's Andrew, who is, it's, to the best of your knowledge, still in the hospital, because it's only been, like, a day.
Yeah, we broke all his legs.
So, yeah, his legs are broken. He's currently at the hospital. You know Martin, who is the, like, owner-operator of Elysium, and then you know his personal lawyer that he introduced to you guys, Paul Kavan. But yeah, you would know them. You've effectively run into them twice and only fought them once.
Okay, we could go visit his friends, I suppose.
All right, do we want to... We don't got the con no more. We can't just leave through a window. This is bullshit. I guess I'll take the elevator. Fuck this. Nice to meet you. I hope you don't see me again, of course. You know, that sort of thing. General, big. He just mumbles to himself. Sort of threatening. Gonna get you. Whatever. And he just, like, starts drinking his water. Hey, this is good.
Thank you. It's imported from Switzerland. We own a spring there. It's bottled directly from it.
We have water here.
She kind of makes a face at you and just goes, "How?"
I'm just saying, it's kind of.
She just goes at what you said. Just goes.
I just feel like that's a waste of money. If we have water here, why would you go all the way to Switzerland to get water?
Oh, honey, I don't personally fetch a pail. I'm not some sort of Swedish milkmaid.
Do you know any?
Personally, no. Oh, why damn. Would I? That, and if anything, she gives a head nod towards Bernadette and just goes, she seems like she would know a cow better than I would.
Not to mention it. She kind of stares at Bernadette for a moment.
Stop thinking of her in a costume. Let's go.
Yeah, fine. How'd you know what I was thinking?
Yeah, I don't. It was obvious.
I actually do know cows pretty well. My daddy is a cattle rancher.
He'll just start making his way out of the office. I guess you called it, actually. That's pretty insightful. Yeah, I guess you are, like, the closest thing to a milkmaid that we actually know. Not Swiss, though. You're not Swiss. Which, you know, you could work on. Have to be a pro. You can take classes.
Oh, I don't think I have any interest in learning the Swedish language.
Could yodel, could take that up.
Oh no, I'm good.
Yeah, you guys can.
Yeah, I'm gonna stop bothering this nice professional actual woman. who is, like, just trying to do her fucking job.
Yeah, Yeah, she's fixing her desk. You did.
Would I have like some kind of information if she ever wants to put some type of accent piece in the middle of her lobby? I can give her like my card or my agent's card.
I was gonna say, yeah, if you have a card yourself, or you know, yeah, you have your agent's card for your sculpture work, if you want to put that on her desk and leave it with her, you are more than welcome to.
Yeah, I do kind of, as we're all leaving, I just end the last one out and go, if you ever want to put something in that lobby so it's not so dreary.
Yeah, she watches you place the card and just looks up at you and just, like, without breaking eye contact, just reaches out, puts a single finger down on the card and pulls it back over to her and just goes, thank you.
Call him. He'll have a portfolio of my work. It's pretty good stuff.
Right. And her finger has not left the card. She hasn't even, like, turned it around to face her. She hasn't broken eye contact with you.
As I meet up with the groom, like, she's not going to call.
Oh, no, you mean she might.
The post-credit scene is her calling.
Okay. Yes, I'd like one sculpture, please.
Yes, I want one big, pretty one.
Yep, the most expensive one you have.
And the least dreary. I'm trying to up it. Up the I'm trying to
put
lower
some
the
wow
dreary
factor in there.
I want something that says, I'm from the Midwest.
Put a bronze cow in the middle of her.
That one's going to fight the one on Wall Street. Taking bets.
Does it exist yet? When was that made?
I think the bull's there.
Okay, the bull's already there? Okay.
Now I'm looking it up, damn it. Oh, it is not there yet.
89.
It was in 89.
Someday you will be able to make the charging bull of Wall Street. That's your
yes.
goal now.
Yes, Bernadette, should you survive, in 2 years you can bring a bull to life and let it run around New York. A giant bronze bull.
Amazing.
Just absolutely fuck up Wall Street. Yeah, you guys can head out. You pop in the elevator, go straight down. There's only really one way to go, and that's out.
Where are we going to now?
Well, I got a few ideas, I guess. The thing about it is, you know, we haven't really been knocking on the door of the Kavans. I'm following this launch score business, but Kavan really been that guy, Paul.
You want to go say hello and beat up another lawyer?
Yeah, that might be fun.
Yeah, that actually does kind of suck.
See, the fun thing about lawyers is they use a lot of starch when they get their dry cleaning done. So when you beat them up, they kind of crinkle a little.
Oh, that sounds amazing.
It really is. Mm-hmm. And then the first thing they say is, you can't do this. I'm going to sue you. Ah, why are you still hitting me? Ah, you can't be beating me up. This is against the law. I'm a lawyer. I'm a scumbag piece of shit. Ah.
Did I really say the last part?
Yeah, in my mind they do.
Wait, I don't know about if I want to go rustle up a lawyer. Is this personal?
Maybe.
What do you got against lawyers? Not that they're, you know, great or anything.
Okay, I'll explain it to you. And I need you to just stay with me on this. You know how when a dog sees a squirrel, like, they see the fuzzy tail, the little bright eyes, and the first instinct is they want to go chase it down and maul it to death. Sometimes when I see a lawyer, I get that kind of urge. There's something about them. They're all put together. They got nice suits. They shake each other's hands. They go to little clubs. They drive nice cars. They got families. And they just walk around like that, you know, just like being people. But then also, they do some of the scummiest shit you ever heard of, really. People in Billy's little commune, for example, probably been fucked over by lawyers more than they realize. For this reason or that, one reason or another. It could be for real estate purposes, or perhaps certain ones have worked with the local government as prosecutors before they went into private practice, that sort of thing. Regardless, these people kind of are on the levers of power a lot for the difference, the wall between the wealthy and those that are not so fortunate. Lawyers are often the executors of the will of those who have power and influence, and they themselves eventually, if they do a good enough job for the masters, might rise to the power level of the people that formerly were employing them for, you know, use of the oppression of the underclass. And that is, of course, another reason why I kind of feel like sometimes, and not every lawyer, of course, I just feel sometimes I just gotta beat them up a little. Just rough them up. Just a little bit. They are one mechanism of many. But they just happen to be the ones that are the least in shape. Get him, get him. He starts punching at the air, a little shadow box. Whammina, whammina, whammina. Some of them do hit the gym, though.
So, you're saying that we're basically doing the universe's will, but balancing a little bit, because the lawyers, they got it coming.
Hey, look. The way I see it, these stands that we got are the great equalizers. There ain't no more just bowing down to simple authority or the police or anything like that. We're higher than that now. We're beyond that. We operate on a different level entirely. And while we have this sort of power and breath in our lungs and a pulse in our hearts, we should be using it to do stuff. Like maybe beat up a lawyer or two. And he starts shadow boxing again. Wamina, 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 wamina. I object. Bam! Subpoena this. You know what I mean?
Don't gotta battle lawyers, cops, or kings.
Alright, I'm absolutely sold. Thank you.
Wait, 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 wait. What was that last one?
Or kings.
Nah, I'm gonna have to... He starts rubbing his finger under his nose as he talks. I don't know about that one. I mean, like, I can see where you're coming from or why you might say that, but... I'm just saying, maybe give it a little bit more consideration before you decide to engage in any kind of, you know, like regicide or anything like that.
No, just beat him up a little.
Yeah, he starts rubbing under his nose again. I mean, like, I could see, like, yeah, it's a fair point. I mean, you know, maybe give it a little bit of thought.
She just kind of grins at him. I'll think about it.
All right, that's good. I mean, I'm not biased enough, don't get me wrong. One should have a good objective worldview if they're going to espouse it, especially if they're going to back it up with action. I'm just saying. on that note, I guess, where should we head next, DM? What feels like the right direction based on the information that we've gotten? Because it is a big city. And we're chasing after kind of some of the threads of these guys.
Well, I'm sure I can find the Kavan Law Practice building in, like, a phone book.
So we just go in, harass the receptionist.
I think Kev gave his card to someone. I don't remember who, but I think he might have given it to Melina. You might have received Paul's card, because I know he did give it to someone. So we can, it ultimately doesn't matter who, because you guys are here. So one of you has it, but I know he did give it away.
It was either me or Mel. I don't remember which.
Yeah. Actually, I think it was Mel because she was the one blocking the door originally when they left.
She'll whip it out.
So she would have it. There's also Andrew, who's just in the hospital. His legs are broke. He's not going to be getting up anytime soon.
He can't run away like Frank.
I mean, you put him in a wheelchair. His stand does the rest. So I guess we've got to be careful.
Honestly, we could
interview him and Diego. Maybe Diego. But definitely Andrew.
I don't feel like Diego was a part of the...
Let's just beat him up. Just beat him up again.
Andrew again.
Yeah, which is JoJo. We gotta beat him up. Like, hey, buddy.
I feel like Diego wasn't in on the nepotism group, so I think Andrew would probably get more answers. But I think we should just go to the address on the card and be like, hey.
Go beat up Kevon.
Just blow it up.
Hiya. Would you like your entire group of lawyers to start a riot? Because I can do that. Would you like to see a lawyer riot?
Oh, man. We're just
Actually, you know what Billy could do?
Yeah.
What time of day is it?
I'd say it's definitely, like, it's after afternoon, so probably, like, maybe 3, 4-ish. People are going to be starting to head home soon.
What time do the markets close?
The markets close at 3 p.m. or 2 p.m. Eastern.
We're too late.
What?
Oh, you should just start a riot in the market.
The market?
You could just do it. You could just do that.
I could. Why would I?
Why would you? This would be amazing.
Is it like Jesus?
No, you just go there, start a riot, and leave. Watches people start, like, fucking losing their minds because...
Okay, Billy has been very careful not to so far.
Just be terrorist. It's fine.
Yeah, you know, just some light terrorism in New York. What could go wrong?
All the previous attempts
have been swimming.
Look, I thought about it as soon as I said I'd bring this building down where I was, okay? But it's off. We're off by a few years.
You've got some time before somebody goes, hey, wait a fucking minute.
No one understands that reference yet.
It's going to be a while. I don't think Van's even going to be able to... He's not even going to be allowed to live in New York past 9/11. They'll just be like, nah, you can't be here anymore.
Can't be. You gotta leave.
Yeah, you gotta
know what you said.
Yeah, you gotta go to, like, fucking Charleston or something. You gotta get the fuck out of here, buddy.
They're gonna send him upstate.
Yeah. I'm the king of Buffalo!
You hear that?
Did anybody hear that? Is anyone... it's 7 p.m. All the stores closed.
Everybody's at the game. Tailgating and shit, and you're just screaming out on the empty streets. This is all mine!
Pay attention to me! Alright, yeah. I'm just trying to figure out where it is, I guess, that we... Because we can go and shake down more people in their offices and whatever, but I guess I'll leave it to you guys to... Are we just going to the Kevon address on the card? Is that... That seemed to be the...
The move.
I'm down for that.
It seems like we want to go beat up a lawyer. To scare him. Put the fear of God in him.
Yeah, I'm totally down with that. But I will be right back real quick. Guys can...
Yeah, we can all take, like, a quick 5.
Okay. All right. Yes, I will. Just 5 minutes.
People can go and eat, drink, and potty.
I do need water. Yeah. Okay, be right back.
Okay, seems like we're all back.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So we're gonna head down to the law offices. The law firm is, of course, Baldwin, Lockwood, Gale, and Kavan. Something I luckily wrote down forever ago.
That seems a very long thing to remember.
Yes. That's why I wrote it down. Thank God. But yeah, we can head there. Yeah, we're here on Wall Street, where money happens, I guess. At least according to the people in Wall Street.
All right, I'm going to start tipping over tables.
Start tipping them up.
Yeah, you can find the law offices. They are part of a much larger building, but they do... Again, seem to have several floors that are dedicated just to them. You guys can head up. Again, you're kind of stopped by a very nice receptionist who's like, "Hi, how may I help you today?" Oh no, it didn't load?
It's just black, yeah.
Oh, hang on. I need to update the settings because it's waiting for you guys to have token vision. I hate that sometimes because I forget it all the time. Okay, there we go.
Hi, I'm looking for the Kavan in the name Baldwin, Lockwood, Gale, and Kavan.
Are you? I'm sorry. Do you have an appointment? You can see she's clearly like looking down at a very large ledger and like looking at her also large computer.
No, I don't have an appointment. I am a very rich person who is very violent, and I need legal representation.
Well. We do have some other individuals. I can get them for you.
No, I want him specifically. And as I mentioned, I am a bit unstable. I should really probably see a therapist. But first, I was told I should talk to a lawyer. I've really done a lot of damage. I'm going to need a lawyer. And I hear he's really good.
There we go. I'll drop you guys in.
I got money.
She kind of like, she seems a little like wild-eyed. She doesn't really understand. Like, criminals don't just walk in and just go, "I'm a criminal. Who's gonna help me?" This is new to her. So she will go and she'll go to reach for the phone and just stop and then look at you and just go, "Are you looking for Mr. Kavan Sr. or Jr.?"
I don't know. Which one would you recommend in my situation?
They're both amazing lawyers. We hired, obviously, some of the best in the cities. Either one. I mean, their names here on it.
I talked to the both of them at the same time.
Oh, Wouldn't the suffix be on the card?
I'll ring them both. And you see she kind of worried and hurried will play several calls.
Tell them make sure to mention I'm unstable.
She looks over, like, she has her back turned to you, and then she turns and looks at you and just turns back. And not like immediately, like he doesn't come running out of like anywhere and everything. But eventually you do see the somewhat familiar face. You've met him before, face of none other than Paul Kavan, comes walking out and, like clocks you guys, but he'll just kind of stare at you all and look at the receptionist and just go, are these them?
Van's gonna, like, hold his arms open. Hey, there he is. I haven't seen you since that high school house party we went to.
Like, you do that and Kavan just stares, like, there's a little bit of confusion on his face, but
what, we ain't recognizable? I'll like fiddle with my hair a little.
Yeah, we're them.
He looks at you all and like and looks at the reception and just goes, we'll be taking the conference room. I know nobody's in there, so excuse us. And she'll just kind of give a very polite nod as he will let you guys back into the back and lead you to a conference room. It's pretty, you know, it's what you would expect from like a high-end law firm. It's, you know, very dark wood, you know, paneled. All the chairs are, you know, have high backs, leather that's also equally dark. You all kind of get filed in, and he closes the door behind you. So, is this, what, shakedown?
The fuck do I need to shake you down for?
I don't know, but you seem to show up at my place of business thinking you can, so I'd say that's ballsy, but
I'd say I could do whatever the fuck I want right now, buddy, considering what you did. If I wanted to stick my fucking finger in your nose, I'd better fucking be able to. Maybe I want to test out my home dentistry training on you. Could do that. Or, you know, I can make you walk around in, like, fucking, you know, socks that are filled with glass. I'm kind of just taking it easy right now because I've been taking a more peaceful approach to life, but I'm going to tell you something right now. It is reaching the end of it, really. I mean, I'm reaching the end of my rope. You know what I mean? So, yeah, we're here because, yeah, you know why we're here. He's going to start cracking his knuckles.
Yeah, he'll just kind of like watch you, you know, square up and get ready, and he'll just go, I don't know what you think you know, or whatever they told you. I'm assuming that you questioned them first before you went and showed up here at my doorstep.
Actually, Ben seems to be looking him over as he's talking.
Yeah, you basically have the right of that.
Also, can you really say yours? She mentioned out there that there is a senior, so I'm thinking this is all your daddy's stuff.
He just kind of gives, like, the, like, faintest of shrugs. He just goes, I mean, he's practically out the door. He just likes to sit around for the most part because he needs something to do and won't go out to the Hamptons. So,
Normally, I'm not like the violent one, but every time you open your mouth, I want to hit you.
I know, right?
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Yeah, he gives a smile, and there's a very, like, you know, there's a flash of just all white, you know, perfectly lined teeth. As you say that, and he just goes, "Yeah, well, anyway, since I guess you all decided you want to try and blow out the like 10th story of a building because you have nothing better to do with your lives, because I'm assuming," and he just very quickly, like, his eyes go straight like through all of you. And he goes, "No jobs or anything like that. No 9-to-5s that keep you busy. Just a lot of sitting around and waiting for what, a fight? Is that what you guys do?"
Yeah, more or less.
I'm a very prominent sculptor.
No, he's got it right. He really does. I just live to fight mostly at this point. No, but she does sculpt. He points at Bernadette. It's actually pretty nice work.
He like looks you over, Bernadette, and just goes, "Well, actually, you know what? Do you have any pieces that you still own or are still around? Do you have like an agent, anything like that?"
"Yeah, I have an agent."
"That's perfect. Do you have a card?"
"Bernadette." Yeah, I give him the card.
Yeah, you hand him the card. He takes it. His entire like face like shifts from like, he's been kind of blasé right now. He is hyper focused on this and like scrutinizing every detail of this card and looking it over, and he just goes, "Well, I mean, I guess if you want to be these kinds of people," and he puts it in his jacket pocket, and he goes, "It'd be nice to own a piece from you know, a dead artist. They always, you know, the price always goes up when that happens, so you know, that'll be fun. Little investment. I don't have my finance guy, because last time I checked, you were trying to cripple him. He didn't come back."
No, we weren't trying to. He did get crippled.
"Oh, so he's alive. Okay, so you did try and so you did question him. Cool. And I'm guessing that means Frank is also what, in some basement, some derelict building."
"He's your own guys chasing after him."
"Yeah, we don't know what happened to him. We left him in a dumpster and then he vanished."
He just kind of nods. "You left him in a dumpster and you're wondering where he is."
"Yeah, pretty much." "Well, so, I mean, you could tell us if you know. I'm guessing you don't, right?"
"Yeah, unfortunately, I don't. See, I have a real job with real stakes that are involved that I have to do every day."
"You know, I could mess up your real job, right?"
"And I could mess up you. Just all of you in general. Especially you." And he like points at you, Van, and he goes, "I've been trying to figure out where I knew you. And it wasn't a high school party, was it? You're one of the Dross kids. I've seen... your family does murals of themselves, what, every year you update it or something? Jesus Christ."
"Yeah, I tell them that they don't. Yeah, I'm not into it. But yeah, they do it."
"Then that's where I know you from. I think it was a Christmas party a couple years ago. It's the last time I saw your face in one of those things. I thought you died, but they said you were off being an artist." "That makes sense."
"It does."
And he does look around at the rest of you.
"I'm hanging out with some real bohemians over here."
"Oh, it certainly looks like it. Well, you know,
have you seen my face on a mural?"
He looks at you, Billy, and just goes, "You seem more like a wanted poster kind of gal. And that's nothing against you, actually. That's kind of cool. You know, or hot, whatever. It wouldn't really matter."
"Well, I'm glad you remember me." And he looks at Billy. Yeah, he's got a point.
She shrugs a little. "I mean, I could paint my own face on your building 10 feet high, but I won't."
"Well, like, you know, really, Paulie. Good old Paulie Cavani, huh? Let me ask you a question real quick. You got really nice teeth. Are those veneers?
No. Not that I can't afford them. I just naturally come with good teeth.
Damn. Oh,
that's gotta be a lie. You know he's had work done. No one has perfect teeth like that naturally.
Let's test it. Ashes to Ashes is just gonna quickly flick a piece of porcelain at his face.
I guess, are you throwing it, like, hard enough to hurt him, or are you just kind of, bleh?
Yeah, like, kind of, like, it's a very quick, small little shard of porcelain that's been charged right at his teeth. As he's, like, talking or doing the weird fake smile
like
or whatever.
Are you doing, like, a coin flip with it, or is it, like, an attack?
It's like finger flicking it. So it's quick, but it's a small one, and yeah, it's an attack. Do you want me to roll for it?
No, I'll say it. Actually, yeah, you know what? Let's make an attack. Why not? We ain't done no rolling yet.
Yeah, what do you want me to... Speed?
Yeah, do speed. Okay. You do that, and Paul is quick enough.
I will fate point it. I want to hit it.
Okay, you can.
I invoke Material Specialist. I need to know this, yes.
See, the fun thing is that I can also fate point it and just overcome it.
You could. Go for it. I don't know. We got to spend some fate points.
Yeah, I will, actually. He has an aspect. I wrote it out in bold text. Will, and then have law and order. So you chuck that piece of porcelain and just... quick as he can, his hand just comes up in front of his face and it just catches in his palm, and he just closes his hand and just goes, that's really childish. I told you they're real. Throw as much shit at you want at me, I guess. You know, throw a punch if you want to try and break them. They're real teeth. They're gonna act like real teeth.
I don't know. He starts rubbing his underneath his nose like, those were some quick reflexes. It's almost like you were defending yourself from getting your mouth blown up.
Well, I mean, I guess if you want to be known as somebody who, regardless of my teeth, assaults a lawyer in his office, you can do that. I'm sure every lawyer here would jump at that.
I think they'd be busy.
Actually, to be honest with you, I didn't want to just beat you up or nothing. I was waiting to talk to you and your dad.
Well, I can assure you he knows so... He actually knows nothing. I don't even know why I would say he knows little. He knows nothing of the day-to-day that goes on here, so you can speak directly to me.
No, I think I want to talk to both of you at the same time. He was supposed to be here. Man looks around. The secretary, your receptionist, said I would be able to talk to both of you.
He just kind of stares at you and then looks back and just goes, yeah, well, you know, she covers for a lot of people doing a lot of things that they should and shouldn't be doing and where they're at. So I don't feel like we need to involve my father in this because, you know, do you really want to be known as somebody who beats up an old man?
No, I didn't want to beat him up.
Well, it sure seems that way. It seems like there's a lot of aggression coming from here. I've had to talk to a lot of people, you know, and kind of feeling them out, and feels like there's a lot of hostility coming from this side of the room, and he kind of does an arm.
Do you know what? Why we're hostile, Paul?
I can take many guesses.
Yeah, sure.
I'd be right.
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah, I'm gonna guess that you guys are. I wouldn't say pissed. Probably there's something beyond that. That you feel indignation, righteousness. Any of those hitting?
Yeah, the righteousness one, I'd say. Yeah. Yeah, some indignation. Righteous indignation, even.
Well, there you go. Put those big words together for you. Yeah. So, what, you're mad that you have the ability to, reshape the world, do whatever you want?
But yeah, my ability to burn this place down to the ground is not really in question. I'm not really mad about. I'm a little mad about that part, but I'm more worried about the, you know, people you're killing.
When you mention like the people you're killing, he kind of just like puts his hands up in like a defensive thing. Whoa, I have done nothing to murder anybody.
Well, I don't think that that's really a matter for you to decide. I don't see why it would be that we would believe you in any regard for any amount of guilt or innocence. That would be ridiculous. Why would we allow you to tell us whether or not you committed a crime? I know you've been a lawyer for a long time, but you really got to pull your head out of your ass on that one.
Oh, no, I would never expect you all to believe me. Obviously, to you all, I'm the bad guy. My word can't be trusted. There's no way.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, no, not, you know, I thought you didn't get it, but you do get it. Yeah, of course you can't ever be. You're a terrible human being. You really are just real scum. I mean...
Do you even know the name of the guy you murdered?
You say that, like, again, I personally, like, stabbed or shot a man, so unfortunately I don't know who you're speaking of.
So your money's just going wherever it pleases, huh?
My money mostly stays in my pocket.
Okay. Yeah?
No, we gotta cut through this whole veil here. See, we just went to Frank's place of work. And we got some information about what Frank was doing. And, well, do I even need to go into details here? Or is it that you are going to, what, gonna put on a brave face? We know what he's been doing. We know that you've been a part of that. And quite frankly, the only question now is like, I mean, kind of like you said, how much violence are we going to have to do here? Is it going to be a lot of violence? I'm a really pro-violence kind of guy, if I'm being really honest. You know that, I'm sure, by now. Word's gotten around.
Well, I mean, the fact you showed up to a club and, what, set fire to it, or set a fire at least, then proceeded to attack the owner-operator, cause several $100,000 worth of property damage. You know, eventually you just start getting into felony territory for all that, so...
Wait, you're blaming us for Elysium?
I mean, the fire didn't start itself, did it?
Wait, hold on.
I don't know of a lot of bathrooms that spontaneously combust. I guess it could happen. You know, New York has old pipes, but the investigation that we had done definitely showed that somebody... broke everything up, got pipes going, sprinkler systems going, and then the entire place inexplicably froze. Do you know how hard it is to explain to somebody that in the middle of June why an entire club has a ambient temperature of 12 degrees?
That was fun, but no, the first time, dear.
Oh, that was a mass hallucination. There was a gas leak. The city had it all done up. There was a whole report. I could send it to you. My people have a copy of it.
Yeah, and is this place gonna have a mass hallucination?
Well, I guess that depends, doesn't it? We can always take it outside. There's a million alleys in this city, and I'm sure we won't be the only bums fighting it out now, would we?
Would you?
Nah, there's a lot of... he's right.
I'd respect him more if he'd just bum fight me in the alley.
Oh. Huh. Yeah. Sure.
I was gonna have a lot of fun in here, but
if we cause a riot on Wall Street, no one's gonna notice a bum fight.
That's true.
It's true.
What do you say? We create a little ambiance, and then we settle this with a little one-on-one bum fight. Our girl versus you.
At that, I would think he has that same, like, shitty smile again, and he just goes, you know what? Yeah, actually, you know what? Why the fuck not? I don't have lunch plans. And he looks between the three of you, Billy, Melina, and Bernadette, and he goes, "So, yeah, I guess it doesn't matter. My friend Martin, or I guess more of an associate. I don't know if I would call him a friend. He is. That's a different story. He did get a look at some of you last time. So he knows about you, Van. And he just kind of like holds a finger out towards the three of you and just goes, Melina and Billy? I don't know which one of you is which. But, you know, he has his weird little machinations and plans. I don't really give a shit. You know, I'm there with him. He's an old friend. But also, if I have to listen to the guy go on another coke rant, I'm going to lose it. So, yeah, why not? Let's cut loose.
All right, well.
Worst case scenario, he goes after you guys with a weird sense of righteous vengeance because he sees me as his closest friend.
So, oh, does he really? See Frank as his closest friend?
And he kind of, he makes this kind of face and just goes, Frank's necessary, but Frank's also kind of a dick. He thinks so highly of himself. And, like, I don't understand all that technical shit with, you know, medicine and the beakers and, like, all those terms. I don't get it. It sounds smart, but, like, you get tired of hearing a textbook read itself, you know?
So it probably wasn't you that sent the assassin after him.
And he kind of stares and just goes, assassin?
Yeah, you'll find about that soon, I'm sure.
Probably after you as well.
Yeah, he lets out, like, just, like, a single, like, ha! He goes, assassin? Wow. Huh. Actually, I didn't know anything about that, so that's fun. But no problem. That's fine.
That's fine? All right.
Yeah, you know, if Martin is doing some weird shit where he thinks everybody's out to get him, I know that's the coke talking, and it's got him paranoid, so let him have that.
Buddy, there's a difference between going on a paranoid rant and sending a psychopath in a biker suit to kill one of your friends. So I am still on board with the whole fighting in an alley thing, but
hell yeah.
Maybe just take a moment to consider your options here. Like really think about it. Necessarily gonna, you know, stop you if you decide that suddenly maybe you don't want to just work with the guy that's sending hitters out after your crew. I could show you the assassin in question if you'd like to meet them.
He kind of like his eyes narrow and he goes, could you produce them? Is that something you could do? Just whip up an assassin out of the shadows like a ninja? And he does like a shitty like martial arts like kung fu move.
As a matter of fact,
I'd pay money to see that.
Okay. Well, I guess we could just go to them, really. If, like you said, you're on lunch, aren't you?
Oh, I've cleared my schedule. Whoever's coming to talk to me today can fuck off.
Right on. Well, it could be quick. I'll even give you the option of willingly entering instead of what I usually do, which is just drop people through the ground into a very lovely place.
Really pretty for sewers, honestly.
But if you're willing to come of your own accord, this doesn't have to be necessarily one of those incidents.
Oh, no. Please, if you've got some, I don't know, weird hidey hole that you're putting people in. I mean, hell, he actually, like, starts undoing his tie, and he does, like, the top two buttons of his shirt, and he takes the tie and, like, folds it up on itself a couple of times, sticks it, like, so that it looks like it's a, like, pocket square almost in his suit jacket, and starts, like, shuffling it off. And he goes, I mean, you've got a weird hidey hole. If it's got enough room, we can just do that there once we get there. I'll take a look at this weird assassin you got, and I guess the assassin is alive, or are you just stringing up bodies?
Do I seem like that kind of weirdo keys guy? Come on.
He looks at you, then like Billy, Melina, Bernadette, and then back to you and just goes like, yeah, no, that's definitely not the weirdest thing that could happen.
Right. Well, Van's going to take some dust and rubble out of his pocket. It's part of his materials. And just start sprinkling them in a circle with ashes to ashes, opening up one of the portals to the Space Oddity. And instead of usual, where it just opens up with like a blast and it's like a sparkler type effect, like kind of shimmery, just gentle kind of fizzing and sparking.
Yeah. I was going to say, is it like that same kind of black cloud that...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Once it's complete, the portal to the Space Oddity is open. Oh, there you go. Before you go in, I do gotta ask. You're not, like, scared of astronauts or nothing, right?
Yeah, he just looks at you and he just goes, are you telling me you captured an astronaut, too? You got a spaceman in there? Is the spaceman the assassin? What, is he shooting people from the moon?
No,
and and you say that and he starts laughing. And he's like, and he collects himself and just goes, all right, yeah, show me this Moon Man laser gun guy. Fucking whatever.
No.
Like, you know, I have friends that are cokeheads. They sound less insane than you do sometimes. This is great.
Van's going to just like walk to the edge of it, say, no, it's not like that. He was there when I got there. And then he's just going to casually jump in.
Okay, yeah. Who else is going?
I'm waiting for... Did Paul already jump in?
Paul will, I guess, go to this grassy little gate space. And if you're waiting for him, Billy, he's gotten his sleeves rolled up now past the elbow. And he takes his arm and he puts his fist on his hip to give you his arm. And he just stares at you with his arm out.
Billy raises one eyebrow, but then shrugs and sort of grabs his arm and pulls them both in.
Yep, yeah, you take his arm and, like, yeah, you go to pull and he just, like, gives. Like, he was going to do the same thing and lead, but you grabbed it. You did it first, so he just, yeah.
Nice.
And so, yeah. Mel, Bernadette, you going to go watch the fight night?
I take a chair with me.
Yeah, they're rolling chairs, but yeah, they're like I said, they're nice, like leather-backed chairs, so
just
you can roll it in.
Wheeling a chair into the hall.
Yeah,
we're gonna have to dodge a falling chair.
Well,
yeah. I didn't say her and the chair are gonna make it out okay. Somebody might break it or something, but at least she didn't bring it to life first, you know. She doesn't need that moral, like, conundrum.
Yeah, if everyone's going in, I guess Melina's also.
Yeah, perfect. All right, you all step forth into the void space that leads to the Space Odyssey, and I think that's a perfect place to call it tonight.
Ah. Bum fight! Well, bum fight!
Bum fight! Bum fight! Actually, if anything, it's like half bum. It's only Billy's.
Billy's the only bum here.
Yeah. But yeah, so let me switch back over. But yeah, I would say the after credits scene, we do see a conversation being had in person. There is, of course, Miss Belinda, who is there, as well as Kareem and another individual. He is, much like the man in the image there, spectacled, mustached, also wearing like a fine suit, one of those like collarless button-ups. And in the middle of the conversation, she goes, and I believe that's everything. I hope that what we provided is worth something to the Speedwagon Foundation. And Kareem will kind of start looking over and scanning the paperwork and just go,
yes, this is so much, actually. It helps connect some dots for us. Thank you. I didn't expect to hear back from Mr. Dross, so this is sort of unexpected. And she goes, yes, well, you know, our research only got us so far. We were hoping that, as uneasy as I feel about this kind of alliance, that we would both learn and gain something from one another. And Kareem nods and just goes, well, this was a pleasure. I will be speaking with you soon. I'll have to confirm everything on this on our end, but thank you. And he'll gather up the papers and leave. And once he's out of earshot, she'll turn to the gentleman and just go, now that that's taken care of, Crash, will you and the team please track down our little flight risk? He seems that he's already gotten a day on us. And bring me that stupid fucking haircut of his. Attach that stupid fucking head. And she gets up and walks away. And a minute goes by and he gets up and walks the opposite direction. And that's it.
There's never been a more threatened man
than Frank.
Maybe he shouldn't have fucked up so hard.
It never loaded in. What does Crash look like?
Oh no.
Oh, hang on.
Yeah, it's true.
If you could just post it in like NBC.
Okay. Oh yeah, yeah. I can do that all day.
Dang.
Actually, I will upload them both because that'll be easier on me.
Thank you.
Why does it always cut to the next song after that? Oh, whatever.
Because you have sequential play on instead of soundboard only, probably.
Oh, maybe that's it. But it doesn't do that with the intro. But it always might plays have back it. To the intro. Whatever.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Oh, it finally loaded. Never mind. He's a mustachioed boy.
Yes.
I have not loaded and cannot see his mustache. His mustache.
Okay, I just put him in NPCs.
Oh, he's beautiful.
You're looking at him.